Hello everyone, I'd like to welcome you to today's Victorian Parliamentary Library webinar, a briefing from the Academy of Technology and Engineering. Today's topic is quantum technology. What is it and why do we need to know? So firstly, just on behalf of the Parliament of Victoria and its members, and also on behalf of the Academy of Technology and Engineering, just want to acknowledge the traditional owners of the lands on which we are meeting, and to pay our respects to them, to their culture, to the traditional owners of those lands. We want to pay our respects to them, their culture, their elders, past and present and future, and elders from other communities who may be with us today. Firstly, I'd like to apologise on behalf of ATSE's Victorian Division Chair, Dr. Bronwyn Fox, who was scheduled to be the moderator for the session today. Unfortunately, Bronwyn has been called away and can't be with us today. So I'm standing in for her. My name is Sue Barrell. I'm also an ATSE Fellow and a member of the Victorian Division Committee. So we have three very distinguished speakers today, and they will do the topic way more justice than I can by trying to say too much more at this point, beyond the fact that we already depend on quantum technology to provide us with many of the essentials of modern life, and that further investment and commercialisation of quantum technologies has the potential to create both economic growth and jobs across a range of sectors. You have the bios of our speakers in the flyer that was sent out for the event. So I'll just give a brief intro to the three speakers. I'll do that up front and then we'll move straight into the speakers to optimise the time we have today. So first up, we have Professor Hugh Bradlow. Hugh is the president of the Australian Academy of Technology and Engineering, and he's also a director of the Australian Council of Learned Academies. Professor Bradlow is globally recognised as a thought leader in telecommunications, and among his many achievements, he's been designated as one of the 12 most influential people in Australian ICT. Our second speaker is Professor Elanor Huntington. Elanor is the Executive Director of Digital National Facilities and Collections at CSIRO, and a non-executive director on the board of ATSE, of Engineering, Industry, Innovation and Science Australia and others. Prior to joining CSIRO, Elanor was Dean of the College of Engineering and Computer Science at the Australian National University, where she helped bring about significant transformation within the sector. And our third speaker is Professor Lloyd Hollenberg. Lloyd is the Deputy Director at the Centre of Excellence for Quantum Computation and Communication Technology at the University of Melbourne, and director of the IBM Quantum Hub at the University of Melbourne. Lloyd is leading the development of quantum computer and sensing technology in Australia, and is an integral part of an international effort to understand and apply these technologies to worldwide problems. So let's go straight to Hugh to open the batting today. Thanks, Hugh.
Thanks, Sue. First of all, good afternoon, everyone. I won't repeat the acknowledgement of country, but thank you, Sue, for doing that. So I'm going to try and answer in the next few minutes the second part of the question of the topic of today is, why do we need to worry about quantum computing? So I'm going to give you a bit of context. And in the first instance, the question is, why is this happening now? And that is, like most of these things, the confluence of opportunity and need. So the opportunity arises from the fact that since the silicon integrated circuit was invented about 70 years ago, people have been trying to cram more and more transistors onto these chips. And in order to do that, they've had to make them smaller and smaller. And now we've reached the point in the 2020s where those transistors are so small that the laws of quantum physics are starting to apply to them because they're operating almost at the scale of individual atoms. So I won't give you a description of what quantum physics is. Lloyd is far better qualified to do that than I am. But in basic terms, quantum physics is a statistical view of the world in which if you have, for example, a sphere with North Pole and the South Pole, in the classical world, that's the sphere is either pointing up or down, but in the quantum world, the sphere can be pointing in any direction on a statistical basis at the same time. However, if you actually measure the state of the sphere, it collapses to either up or down, the classical view of it. So that means that environmental issues, which are normally in the environment, like noise or sound or light or heat, have a big impact on quantum systems. And that means that you have to create special conditions in order to use them. But if you can manipulate individual atoms, and you can, people have found ways of doing this, then you can exploit these remarkable statistical properties of quantum computing, quantum statistics, to do useful things. And that brings me to what are these useful things. I do just want to point out, though, before I go there, that you've got to understand that the science to be able to manipulate individual atoms is quite extraordinary. A square centimeter of silicon, which is probably a big silicon chip, has over 600 trillion atoms in it. So you're trying to do something with one in 600 trillion atoms, which is the fact that you can actually do that is quite remarkable. So when we talk about quantum technology, there are basically three different areas. The first I'll mention is quantum sensing. This is the ability to exploit quantum effects to do very precise measurements. So I'll give you two examples. In theory, it would be possible to use quantum sensing to measure electromagnetic waves, which means that you could have a very tiny antenna in your phone, which would be able to measure much smaller signals than we can do in today's phones, and therefore extend the coverage of the mobile network dramatically if you had that in the device. Another example, which people have actually applied to prospecting for minerals, is you can do exquisitely accurate gravitational measurements, that which will allow you to determine what is the density of the different materials underground, and that will give you a clue as to whether they're valuable minerals there or not. The second area, which Elanor is going to talk about in a moment, is quantum communications, which is using these quantum capabilities to provide you communication links that are provably secure. And then the third area is quantum computing. And this is probably, in many ways, the most exciting and the most interesting area, because there's certain problems that we cannot calculate on today's computer. So about 40 years ago, Richard Feynman, who was one of the key physicists of the 20th century, observed that if you wanted to model nature, you wanted to model chemical processes, drugs, etc., you really needed to use quantum computing in order to do so, because the size of the problem would grow exponentially with how big the molecule was. Now, why is that useful? So if you let me give you one example, is the chemical process used to create nitrogen fertilizers, or in fact used to create ammonia, which is used to create nitrogen fertilizers. By the way, 30% of that of which come from Russia, so it's a chemical process that's going to be of considerable importance to us, is called the Haber-Bosch process. And that consumes something like 2% of the entire world's energy. It's so energy intensive. You have to create very high temperatures and very high pressure. If you could find a catalyst that would reduce the temperature or pressure or both for that process, there would be a huge saving in terms of both cost and greenhouse effects. Another major problem that quantum computers, it's hoped, will solve is what's called quantum machine learning. Today's artificial intelligence is basically machine learning. And as the problems get bigger, so does the consumption of energy and the time it takes to train these artificial intelligence algorithms. And it's hoped that quantum computers will cut that Gordian knot and make it much simpler and less energy intensive in order to train artificial intelligence in the future. And then the third major class of problems that quantum computers will solve are so-called optimization problems. So if I give you an example, if we wanted to be able to optimize all the traffic on Melbourne's roads, we're talking probably about 5 million cars on the road system. To be able to do that with a classical computer and have every car go through the most optimal route would be beyond the capabilities of today's classical computers. But in theory, a quantum computer would be able to find the optimal route for every car. So that's it in a nutshell, why quantum computers are important. And with that, I'm going to hand over to Elanor to speak about quantum communications. Thank you.
Thank you, Hugh. So I'm going to just touch on a couple of key items and hopefully use that to stimulate some discussion later on. The two things that I would like to talk about are, rather than going through how quantum communications works, maybe just talk about what it's good for, and then talk a little bit about the external context that sits around some of the work that we're doing in the quantum technology space. So as Hugh said, there's lots of prospect and interesting and exciting things that could potentially be done with quantum systems. One of the things that was tacit in the points that Hugh made is that we're talking about atoms, and that conversation was around quantum mechanical objects that are generally quite delicate, don't live for very long in the environment, and generally don't move around very well. So if we want to move quantum information or quantum behavior or quantum processes around in space, then we have to find a way to do that. And so that's what quantum communications is, in the same way that classical or conventional communications works. It's about moving information around in space as well as time. And so quantum communications is useful for three things. One of which is the one that Hugh touched on, which is something that we call quantum key distribution. And the idea there is that if we wish to communicate in a secure way, then somehow or other we need the two or many people who are communicating with each other need to share some kind of a secret key so that they can encrypt and then decrypt the information that they want to share. The way that gets shared is a very complicated thing. And one way to do that is for all of the people who know that they want to communicate securely to come together in time and space at one point and write down in a little logbook exactly all of the ways that they're going to do that encryption. Then they go out into the world and they can send encrypted text amongst each other, but they've got their logbook and so they know how to do the encryption and the decryption. The problem with that, of course, is that you've got a finite size logbook and you can't keep doing that forever. So what quantum key distribution does is it solves the problem of how you would transmit those keys securely. Once you've all come together once, then you go your separate ways and you can then use quantum mechanical techniques to transmit those keys and use protocols that, as Hugh said, are provably secure. So that's why these days we started the world talking about quantum encryption, but actually it's quantum key distribution. So another way that quantum communication is useful is to transmit quantum information from one place to another, potentially using only conventional communications channels like the normal internet. As we've all said on a number of occasions, quantum devices, quantum mechanical objects are very delicate. And so the idea of squishing a quantum object down a normal telecommunications system is that's simply not going to work. One other way to do it, as one of my colleagues pointed out many years ago when we were having a robust conversation around what quantum communications might be, would be that if you could actually build a sufficiently stable quantum mechanical object, you could then put it on the back of a bus and then drive the bus from Melbourne to Brisbane and it'd all be fine. Yes, that's true, but it requires a very long lifetime for a quantum mechanical object and it's kind of low bandwidth because you're limited by the size of the bus. So another way to, transmitting quantum information from one location to another is a key task, not just when we are contemplating connecting up, say, a quantum internet of devices, but also even simply transmitting quantum information within a complicated and at scale computer just inside the same casing. And in terms of and in parallel to the way that conventional computers work, where they are constantly moving data around in order to do the calculations. And in fact, I'm coming to you today from Perth, where yesterday I spent some time looking at the Pawsey supercomputer, and the amount of internal communication inside of that computer is just astonishing. And so we're going to need to be able to do that inside of full-scale quantum computers as well. So the third thing that quantum communication is useful for, the third and last one, is to be able to transmit conventional information more efficiently. So Hugh touched on the idea that machine learning is at least in principle doable for very, very large numbers of very large data sets, but it takes a very long period of time, and conventional machine learning algorithms consume vast amounts of energy. It's only growing the more complex the calculations that people try to perform. So again, back in the day when we used to talk about transmitting conventional information more efficiently, we used to talk in terms of signal to noise ratios. And again, in robust debates, colleagues would say, well, so that's fine, just turn the laser power up. But we're getting to the point where the amount of information that we're trying to move around the world is vast. We all understand about the carbon dioxide emissions associated with the energy consumption to do with that. And so these days we're not so much limited by compute power as we are limited by actual power and the carbon emissions that come from that. So they're the three main ways that quantum communications are useful. And I thought I'd touch a little bit on some of the thinking around how this might play out in the world and some of the advanced work in that area. So again, three things there. One is that there is an emerging conversation around what many of us are calling critical technologies. And something quantum technologies are part of that list. They are considered for Australia to be a critical technology. What one has to do in order to make it to that list is that technology needs to be not only strategically important in terms of the geopolitics of the day, both in a security sense, but also potentially economically incredibly important. And so for Australia, quantum technologies are indeed a critical technology. We can touch on all of the reasons why, in a security sense, having quantum technologies is an important thing for a nation state. But in addition to that, Australia does indeed have a world competitive, globally significant set of capabilities in this area, and has been building that from a fundamental research base in Australia for many decades. And that leaves us in the fortunate position of being able to take advantage of the emergence of these technologies out of the research area and into our economy. Quantum technologies are also they tick the second box in the needs to become a critical technology, because they have the potential for Australia to drive Australia's economy in really constructive and positive ways. Speaking of why potentially this might become important for nation states, couple of other developments. The United Nations have just recently agreed and published something that they call the Norms of Cyberspace. So there, if one speaks to the rules-based order, there's a set of now agreed norms for how nation states will behave in cyberspace. And as you will have gathered, many of these quantum technologies operate in that domain. That means that it's an important part of the way that we need to think about our world going forward. They color code their norms as green norms and red norms. Green norms are the good things one should do, and the red norms are the things that they would like nation states not to do. And we can potentially have a conversation about that. Finally, the World Economic Forum have just recently published something that they call the Quantum Computing Governance Principles, which are a little bit more granular than the United Nations norms of cyberspace, but they cover very similar things in terms of some suggestions coming from the World Economic Forum around some principles that should be applied in terms of the development and utilization of quantum technologies, specifically quantum computing in this case, as again, they emerge from research areas and move into the economy and the world and our lived experience. And so on that note, I will hand over to Lloyd.
Thank you very much. Pleasure to be here, and thank you to our ATSE friends for organising this. Because I'm in lecturing mode at the moment, I can't help but have PowerPoint slides and something to point to, so let me just bring them up. Is that okay, sir? Good, okay. So Hugh and Elanor gave some very nice descriptions of quantum technology and in Eleanor's case, in particular, quantum communication. I'll also give a little bit of an overview of what is quantum technology, but of course we don't have much time here, so I'm not going to get into the physics, but I figure there's never too many explanations of quantum technologies, right, to absorb. So one way to think of quantum technologies is, as was mentioned, we do actually have technologies that are predicated on quantum things, and a familiar technology is MRI. What you may not realize is that MRI images are actually based on measuring billions of quantum objects, in this case protons, that exist in biological tissue. But in the images, we're not actually, and in the process, we're not actually harnessing these key quantum effects that we're talking about when we talk about quantum technology. Suffice to say that when quantum mechanics was a theory that was developed, people like Einstein and others realized that within the theory, there are things that are allowed that greatly worried people like Einstein. And in fact, he just didn't believe them. But indeed, these strange and weird effects are actually true. We've been able to verify these things experimentally. And these are basically what underpin quantum technology and what makes it very different to this sort of first level of quantum technology in MRIs. So one way to define them is that the distinguishing feature, as Hugh was saying, is that individual quantum objects are controlled and exploited. And these individual quantum objects could be atoms or photons or even very small superconducting circuits that behave quantum mechanically. The aspects of quantum mechanics that we're harnessing here means that technology based on that, quantum technologies, when they harness these aspects of the quantum world, lead to very new functionality in devices, in the technology that we can build on this science. And what we're seeing is that this transformative functionality has a range of application areas. And there are three main ones that people generally talk about, as you've seen already, computing, sensing and communication. So I'll probably focus more on computing in what I'll be talking about. And what I'll try to do is say a little bit about what's happening in the Australian context, but contrast that with what's happening internationally, so we get that perspective. So first of all, CSIRO recently wrote a really nice report on quantum technology and the economic opportunity for Australia. And this split into the three areas there. And it's very interesting to see the relative contributions from each of those areas. You know, they're potentially quite significant. By far the dominant one is computing. So quantum computing, because computing is prevalent in many areas of society, that's obviously going to be quite far reaching. I'll talk about that in a little bit. And there's quite a bit going on in terms of the national conversation. So there's currently a national quantum strategy process happening, and people around the country now are at this very moment, I suspect, writing their submissions to that. So there's a lot going on. And as Elanor indicated, Australia is actually in a really strong position. We've been funding very strongly R&D in quantum science and technology for well over two decades now. And it's predominantly been through the ARC's funding of Centres of Excellence, which are long-term programs, 7 years. And in the case of the centre that I belong to and Elanor had belonged to as well, that's this Centre for Quantum Computation and Communication Technology in one guise or another has been running since the early 2000s. So that longevity of funding has been incredibly important to underpin the R&D in quantum technology. And there's been other centres of excellence as well. EQUIS is another very important centre in regards to quantum technology development. And I think this is one of the primary reasons that Australia has such strength at the moment. We're now seeing, in terms of translation, we're seeing the rise of startups that are particularly Australian, and they cover a range of areas from quantum computing, communications. Quintessence Labs is the first quantum technology company in that respect in Australia, and all the way through to hardware development in quantum computing and software development. So it's a very exciting time, and I expect that list to grow very rapidly. And I think that's one of the challenges we have in Australia, is to take this strength in fundamental R&D and translate that to commercial activity. So let me zero in on quantum computing a little bit more. I mean, that's usually the most recognizable of the quantum technologies. It is, after all, a computer, and it's meant to run algorithms. And I think we're all fairly familiar with how, you know, computers do that. Quantum computers just do it in a very different way. And people who code quantum computers need to learn the different rules of how quantum information is processed in these devices in order to optimize how you run algorithms and how you then engage with end user applications. But pretty much what we're seeing now is if you have a problem, there will be a quantum algorithm that will be able to implement that on a quantum computer. The trick is how well you can do that on a quantum computer, and can you beat a classical computer, a conventional computer, in doing that? That's really the holy grail of all of this. And so there are many people working on this now. And I just want to show you some of the highlights of what's been happening in recent years. So for decades, quantum computers were basically confined to high-level research labs around the world, and they're just starting to emerge now. This is primarily because there's been a huge amount of investment by the major tech companies, Google included. One of the first big results was, in fact, from Google on one of their superconducting quantum computers. And this was the result that they call quantum supremacy. At a high level, they were basically programming random programs into their quantum computer and comparing how long it took to get reasonable output from that device compared to simulating the quantum computer totally on a supercomputer. And what they found was quantum computer device was able to produce data in minutes, whereas the supercomputer, which was an IBM Summit machine, took days to simulate that output. So there's an indication that for that particular problem, which is a esoteric random program type problem, the quantum computer was able to outperform the supercomputer. So that was a very exciting result. A year later, a result came out of the University of Science and Technology in China, which is more along the lines of quantum advantage. So here they were able to show that their photonic device, so a quantum computer based on light, was able to produce results for a particular problem. It was called the Gaussian boson sampling problem. Still a fairly esoteric problem, but nevertheless, the results that they were able to get in minutes or hours was basically comparable to what the number one supercomputer, Fugaku, would achieve in 600 million years. So that's an extraordinary claim. And if that is true, that's an incredible indicator of the potential power of quantum computers. Of course, you don't always get such an improvement in speed and power. It is heavily dependent on the problem. And I think one of the major challenges that I believe we will see met in the next few years is to demonstrate quantum advantage in some sense on real world problems, not these esoteric problems that physicists like to play with, but things like traffic routing or machine learning and so forth. And associated with that are the translation challenges. We really need to start getting end users engaged in this technology. The quantum computers exist now, you can program them. They're just not powerful enough to actually produce results on real world problems that you couldn't produce on a supercomputer, but I believe they're getting close. And associated with that is to establish commercial pathways for really translating that fundamental knowledge. And of course, the really big thing that everybody talks about is, well, okay, that's well and good. And if it's happening in the next 5 to 10 years, we really need to start thinking now about developing a quantum ready workforce. So let me just say a few things about the global activity and where other countries are heading. So it's pretty clear that the world is moving now to establish fairly large national quantum computer facilities in order to meet those challenges. And there's a very interesting US PCAST from 2020 that talks about the need to establish facilities in the US that are very strong on end user engagement with the technology. There's also not just these major initiatives in these countries, but a lot of startups happening. And one of my favorite diagrams, which I believe is produced by an ex PhD graduate of mine, Simon Devitt, is this contrast of what's happening in the commercialization space from 2015 to more recently. And you can see the huge growth in not just hardware activity, so the axes are sort of splitting out hardware, software, startups and corporations. So you see a lot of corporations getting into this, but a huge amount of startups that are coming into the software space. It's an incredibly exciting time. And to give you an example, IBM has been establishing a global quantum network that is really dedicated to engaging with research institutes and industry around their emerging technology. And I mention this because in Australia at the University of Melbourne, at the time that the IBM quantum network was being launched in late 2017, we established the quantum network hub for Australia and New Zealand here. So we have access to all the emerging state-of-the-art quantum computer technology from IBM, which has really spurred a lot of activity at the University of Melbourne in terms of learning how to program these devices and engaging with people outside of quantum physics, which is where I work. So these are the generic sovereign priorities in quantum computing, obviously developing a quantum hardware capability. And in Australia, we have companies devoted to that, SQC, Quantum Brilliance, and a newfound company, Dirac. But also with that, we really need to develop the quantum software capability and really push on the end user engagement. And just some of the activities in Australia, as I mentioned, the IBM Quantum Hub at the University of Melbourne is dedicated to that. And the startup Q Control is working very heavily on developing quantum software and firmware. And of course, in all of that, we really need to think of quantum workforce training. And that's happening at universities. At Melbourne University, we've got several subjects and we've trained some 300 students in programming quantum computers over the last few years. And the Sydney Quantum Academy is a new initiative that's really dedicated to this as well. So just to finish up with the Victorian perspective, so we actually have a proposal into Breakthrough Victoria to establish a Victorian Centre for Quantum Computing. And this is basically underpinned by all eight of the Victorian universities through the Victorian Quantum Technology Network that's chaired by the lead scientist, Amanda Caples. And with the aims are really to lower the barriers for industry and university to start engaging with the technology. It's actually not cheap to start accessing quantum computer technologies. There are different ways to do that now, but the idea is to lower that barrier as much as possible to encourage that interaction. So that's all about providing access to state-of-the-art quantum computer systems, and this now as vendors are really starting to emerge, not just IBM and Google, but other companies, we see that opportunity arising to be able to provide that access, that subsidised access to multiple types of technology. This centre would have a very strong focus on training and upskilling in order to capture that growth in the ICT industry that we're expecting and the CSIRO report was really talking about. And I think this is a very good opportunity to establish Victoria as a national leader in quantum software and end user engagement. So I think I might have gone a little bit long, but I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Lloyd. And thank you, Hugh, Elanor, as well, for your introductory, for your various comments on the different elements of quantum sensing, communications, and computing. We've got about 9 minutes left, so we might go straight to any questions. There's one in the chat there at the moment, in the Q&A at the moment, so I encourage any others to come in. But let's just go to that first question that's there. And I guess it's a very practical question. Is there any practical use of quantum computing in Australia? I'm guessing, given the investment in the research, that we're certainly expecting that there will be. But would anyone like to particularly talk to some practical examples that may be on the horizon or underway at the moment?
I can probably have a go at that, and anybody else can jump in. As I indicated, there are lots of potential applications that people are finding. So we work with Ford on problems such as traffic optimization, which is a very important problem, and Hugh mentioned this one as well. But the techniques that we use, we adapt to that particular problem. But the optimization techniques we use can be adapted to a range of similar networking optimization and so forth. But there are other problems as well, and it's not just really Australian specific. I mean, any advanced economy has, I think, a very similar suite of problems. People are working in finance, in machine learning, and material simulation.
Thanks, Lloyd. Hugh, okay. Or Elanor?
Sue, yeah, I would look at the question slightly differently. The question really should be, is there any application of a quantum computer for which someone would pay money today? And the short answer is binary, it's no. But you've got to look at that in the context of when the first semiconductors were created in the early 1950s. It took 25, 30 years before we saw personal computers, mobile phones, all the things that we take for granted today. So it's going to take time to reach a point of what I think of as quantum advantage, where someone would pay real money to get a problem solved that can't be solved on a classical computer. But that shouldn't color one's view of the importance of quantum computing going forward. You know, that invention of this silicon chip by Jack Kilby in 1952 or something heralded the digital age, and the quantum computers that are being built today are heralding the quantum age. It's a whole new world that's going to emerge, but it's not going to take days, it's going to take years. And just reminding you of the old Bill Gates adage, we always tend to overestimate the short term and underestimate the long term. So there's a knee in this hockey stick curve, and we've just got to wait for that knee.
Thanks, Hugh. No more questions in the list at the moment, but please send any more in. Maybe one that I could throw on in, and that is, clearly there's a lot of investment happening in China and the US and other countries around the world. What particular advantage, I mean, given that they're so much bigger than we are in financial terms, as and perhaps risk-taking as well. What are the particular opportunities for Australia in this space? Where do we have the edge?
Well, I believe we have the world-leading quantum technology. And recently at a conference in Sydney, Sir Peter Knight, who's one of the leading UK figures, described Michelle Simmons's technology as the world's leading silicon quantum computing technology. And if you look at, you know, everyone proclaims the advantages of their various technologies, but we definitely, silicon is one of the most promising, and we have leadership there. So I don't believe that throwing more money at it is going to solve the problem. And the other thing is, you've got to look at the supply of skilled people. As Lloyd mentioned, we've been doing this for decades. And so there are quite a lot of skilled quantum computing people in Australia. And, you know, my guess is if you go around the world, there are probably only about 2,000 people worldwide who really know what they're doing. Yeah. In fact, I heard Scott Aronson, who's one of the leading quantum computing people, say at that same conference that the only thing that has more hype in it and more people who don't know what they're doing is than quantum computing is blockchain. So it's, you know, you really do have to look at our skill base and say we have a lead there.
Yeah. Thanks very much for that. Maybe one for Elanor as well. When you talk about quantum communications, I didn't really get a feel for what sort of scale. Are we talking short distance, you know, communication, long distance within a building, internationally? And if we are talking long distance, how do you then do that getting together to exchange those keys in the first place, especially when we have things like COVID happening?
That's a good point. So, in principle, the answer is almost every scale. So, as I said, the scale of communication across an actual quantum computer, all the way out to international scale communication. And in fact, there are significant efforts and some in principle demonstrations for using satellite-based quantum key distribution, for example. Obviously, there are some very significant challenges associated with doing it at those scales and doing it very efficiently and at high speeds. And you were asking previously about some of the places where Australia has a distinct advantage. One of the places where Australia has a distinct advantage is in something called quantum memory for light, because as we've said either explicitly or tacitly through this conversation, quantum objects are really very delicate, and they can very quickly become not quantum and therefore not useful. And that's as true for light as it travels through space or through optical fibers. And so one of the ways that you can, there are proposed techniques proposed to correct that, but those techniques require the use of quantum memory to store some of the photons and perform operations on them. Australia happens to be one of the world leaders in this particular area, and it's another opportunity for distinct competitive advantage for Australia. But certainly the aspiration is indeed global scale potential for quantum communications, and it's certainly not beyond the bounds of possibility. And your question about it coming together initially to share that key, yes, the metaphor I used was the old school way of sitting down and writing down a series of codes in a logbook. These days, provided that you're perhaps in an environment that you both trust and you both consider to be secure, you might be able to do that through contemporary communications. But then once you get out into the cruel, cruel world where you don't necessarily trust the people around you, that's when you need to go to quantum key distribution, having started somehow.
And speaking of trust, you also talked about global protocols, and I think you talked about norms of cyberspace. Is this a voluntary code, or how are these things going to be managed if we are dealing with such sensitive issues, and particularly in a world where security is so important?
Yeah, and look, that's an incredibly wise question. And to some extent, in the end, the global norms of how we behave are indeed entirely voluntary right from the start. So the UN global global norms for the UN norms for cyberspace are indeed UN ratified. So nation states that wish to satisfy themselves and the people in the world around them that they are engaging effectively with what we consider to be the current rules-based order of the world and engaging effectively with the UN have all agreed to and passed and ratified and signed up to these norms. And if they want to continue to be able to say that, then this is one of the ways that they can do that. So to the extent that that is something that a nation state wants to do, then they've signed up to it. And then the question, of course, is always, does one want to continue to do that?
Thank you, Elanor. I think we're just at the end of our time here. So if I can thank all of the speakers, I think we've had a really broad introduction to where quantum is at the moment and where it can take us. And I think highlighted a lot of the opportunities for Australia, including areas as we've highlighted where there are particular strengths here that we can take to the world. The challenge, I suppose, is to position ourselves for those opportunities and really build on that initial investment and really target where we can add value into the future and add further investment. So thank you to our speakers and thank you to the Parliamentary Library for hosting us today.